If a BMS engineer develops a smarter control strategy that when downloaded into field controllers saves energy, but that energy saving cannot be proven to the building owner, then there is no saving. Let me say that again. If you design a smarter control strategy and you write the words out in your document and you take those words and you use your brain and you convert them into software code and you download controllers, and when you download those controllers, if the result is that the supply fans slow down a little bit and the pumps slow down a little bit and the chiller uses a little bit less power, it's actually saving energy. But you can't prove that to the building owner 6 months later, then there was no saving. I'll exaggerate this point slightly by saying, if you're not going to develop a plan up front before you start downloading controllers of how you're going to prove that saving to the building owner, don't even bother starting at all. Bear with me, this is very important. It's called measurement and verification. People get a little freaked out when I say that, so let's just try and discuss this in a bit more detail. The BMS company that you work for right now, if we go back to when they first created this BMS company, you know, 10 years ago, 20, 100 years ago, when a couple of people got together, two or three people, and they said, look, why don't we put our mortgages on the line? Let's risk everything to create this BMS company. Why'd they do that? Do you think they did that because they wanted to provide value to building owners? Do you think they did that, create those companies to have better temperature control, more reliable control systems, to save energy in buildings? Like, probably yes, but the real reason why BMS companies exist is to make money. BMS companies do not exist for fun. So through this control strategy optimization piece of work, we're not doing it for fun. We're doing it for a reason. Now, obviously in the net zero program, we're doing it for free, you know, to save the environment, to try and help with that. But ultimately this work that you do, it has to provide value to the building owner. You've got to prove your value so that even if we're not earning money in the next year or so, it's more likely that the building owner will sign off on other fee proposals and it will differentiate your company from your competitors. So when we do this work, we have to prove our value for all those reasons. And to prove our value, we've got to show them that this download that we're doing, this piece of work, it saves energy, it reduces kilowatt hours. You've got to prove that to the building owner. Because it's highly unlikely that an electric meter exists on a board that exactly is going to prove the reduction in power consumption for this little thing you're doing, whatever it is you're doing. That doesn't happen. That electric meter also has the car park exhaust fans on it and toilet exhaust fans on it, things that you don't need to know. So you have to think about, how am I going to prove this to the building owner and prove my value? How am I going to do that? What do I need to create to prove that? Now there's two other things to consider here. It's not just about proving the savings to prove our value. The other two parts of it are, you need to create these extra, you know, software points or virtual meters or whatever they are, other than proving to the owner, but to prove to yourself that what you're doing is working. So as you make changes and you tweak things, because remember, the control strategy itself doesn't save energy. It's you that adjusts it, the flexible points, that saves energy. So if you're doing that and you're tweaking parameters, you need something to look at that says, okay, yeah, oh, that's working really well. Oh yeah, great. Oh, hang on a sec, I've gone too far. This bit of energy efficiency work on this system, which is going well, is now negatively impacting somewhere else. I've got to stop and come back a few steps. So the second part is, We need to create this measurement and verification process, create new points, new trends, you know, maybe even a new graphic that we can use to analyze, you know, how well we're doing in our energy efficiency tuning. Because comfort control is really easy. You know, in the past, when we were trying to improve comfort control and we were tuning PID loops, we could see very easily that the supply temperature was steady and the supply pressure was steady. Our tuning is working very well. We get less temperature complaints. Our tuning is working very well. The temperatures on the floor are a tighter band. It's working very well. Comfort control is very easy to tune and get feedback. Energy efficiency tuning is very complicated because right now, the way we build BMS systems, we haven't built them in a way that the information is there for us to help us understand how we're doing. The third thing is, well, another thing to consider, I've touched on this before, I think in part two, but you know, we're gonna do lots of good work for free in this first year. It's gonna be amazing. Everyone's gonna love us to death. But ultimately, there's only so much we can do for free during our preventative maintenance hours. So we need to prove our value, which means we can show the building owner graphs, January, February, March, April, May, with reduced power consumption, reduced kilowatt hours, or we can show them that when we optimized the optimal start module, this was the result. Here's a PDF, that's what we did. Look at that, it's amazing. We did this on the VAVs and the AHU slowed down. Look at this PDF, there's the before, the after, the kilowatt hours, you know, temperature overlaid across the top, whatever it is. We have to do that. So that in year two or year three, when we go to the building owner and say, look, wow, this has been amazing, man. Look what we've done here. But to go to phase two in our optimization program, we need to buy some variable speed drives or magnetic flow meters, or it's heavy work that really needs to be delivered as a proper project, quality assurance, using design guys, you know, offshore engineering, whatever it is. At that point in time, the building owner is going to say, yeah, I'm going to sign off on that because I trust you. I believe you. You've proven your value. So there's a lot of important reasons for us to think about now, how are we going to prove the savings, to prove the reduction in kilowatt hours? So like, how would we do this? A couple of examples. Now, I can't go into this into too much depth. This is getting too long, this video. Most of what we're going to do to start off with is going to have something to do with, you know, running the AHUs for a less amount of time for optimal start, or, you know, the fans running slower as we do things on the VAVs, for example. So a very simple thing would be in the low-rise plant room, we go and add up the kilowatt hours from the 6 supply fans and the 6 return fans. We add that up. Now, most modern buildings nowadays, you know, less than 10 years old or so, we have network connections to all of our variable speed drives. So through the HLI, the high-level interface to the variable speed drives, you can map out the kilowatt hours for each of the VSDs. So you create a virtual meter called low-rise VAV AHU fans. It's one point. It's the total kilowatt hours consumption of the low-rise fans that serve the VAV boxes, for example, the main air handling units. And the high-rise, we do the same thing. Now, these aren't necessarily just a trended point, a virtual point. It's better if it's an actual virtual meter. So when you click on it and it opens, you can see, you know, January, February, March, April, the kilowatt hour power consumption, or weekly or daily. You know, what is the reduced kilowatt hours this week compared to last week when I changed the software? And then, like, for example, in the chill water system, you could add up, you know, the electrical power from the 3 chillers through the high-level interface, or sometimes we have electric meters for them, and we add to that virtual meter the 3 chill water pumps, the 3 condensed water pumps, the 3 or 4 cooling tower fans. So there's one point called chilled water system, which is the entire complete chilled water system, totalized kilowatt hours of all the equipment up there. So now when we're tuning our optimal start module, we can see that, you know, we're starting the chillers, we're pre-starting to prime the system. It's not running very fast. What's the kilowatt hours of that? And then the AHU started 50 minutes later. What was the total combined kilowatt hours of the AHUs? if we know, a lot of the things we do are gonna need this, but the main point here is not the detail of what I'm saying, it's you need to stop before you download controllers and think about, okay, when I download the controllers and I'm tweaking these parameters that I know I'm gonna have, how am I gonna understand what the saving is? How can I prove it? And to be fair, it would be fantastic if we'd done this 2 years ago. We'd have all this data, but we don't. So you gotta create these virtual points and create these virtual meters and train them maybe for like, you know, 1 week, 2 weeks or 4 weeks before you actually make the software change, because you need to be able to see this is what the chiller plant and the AHUs did during optimal start in this season. I made the change and now the chiller plant is doing something else and the AHUs are doing something else. Kilowatt hours wise. What was it before? Download the software. What is it like afterwards? Save that, wrap it up into a PDF, put it there. Because it's too hard to come back 6 months later. Oh, what did I do? When did I download those controls? Did I download them in March or when was it? Get it ready now to prove your value. The control strategy, the code, it's the easy part. This is difficult. And in some situations, you're gonna find that everything around the code, the planning, updating the design documents, working out a measurement and verification plan, building all those points beforehand, collecting data for a few weeks, afterwards looking at the data, tuning your system against the new points that you created that you never had before, creating the PDF with the graphs to give to your customer, and to create case studies to celebrate what you've done on LinkedIn. That stuff is more complicated than writing the code. It's more difficult. The control strategy is the easy part. Don't jump into it. There's more important things to do. And the control strategy doesn't save energy. It's you that saves energy. Your dedication and your professionalism saves the energy. Do you see now from those two points, the code, it's not that important. See in the description below for more details of what to do next.